I just want to introduce, as I've told before, we have Sam Rowland from Vancouver, Canada. He's a singer, he's an author, he's a musician, he's a comedian, he's a communicator, all in one. We cannot get such a wonderful package ever. So I just welcome him the traditional way, and then there's something interesting. So I request him to come up. Let's put up our hands together.
Thank you so much. That's so beautiful. Thank you. Thank you so much.
It's all yours.
Okay. Well, it is such a privilege to be here with you. And as you may know, I'm coming from Canada. And we're just going to switch a video projector over to this other laptop here. And we're going to start with a short video to show you what's happening in Canada.
Just putting the feeder hose into the back of the machine. We're getting water directly from the lake over there.
Is that a blanket or get something like a warm?
Hey guys, we've got company. Let's just move away from something.
It's a bear, it's a bear.
It's fine, we're fine. Just calmly walk over here. We're fine. You too, sir. Now please. Let's just give the bear a minute. He's gonna move on. Just let the bear be.
Whoa, what's the...
Sitting in my chair.
That is insane. It got that clean on a cold cycle.
Okay, can we go back to work now, Mr. Ranger?
The bear's now leaving. Okay, gang. It's good. It's clear for us to go back in a second.
It's a polar bear.
All you wanted to do is use the washing machine.
I wasn't scared.
You were.
No.
My batteries are going to run out.
There's not much we can do but sit here.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome from Vancouver, British Columbia, Sam Rowland.
Well, good evening once again. We're going to start with a song called Brand New Heart, and there's a special clap that we do together that goes like this. One, two, three. I got a brand new heart. A brand new heart. A brand new heart. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Brand new heart. I'm in old jeans, playing old guitar. Driving old red Chevy, don't get me too far, but no matter, I got a brand new heart. Ain't got no compact disc, got an old stereo. It's getting harder to find good 8-tracks anymore, no matter, I got a brand new heart. Sing it with me now, I got a brand new heart. A brand new heart. Brand new heart. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Brand new heart. Who really cares what kind of clothes you wear, what kind of car you drive, what you goop in your hair, what matters? Do you have a brand new heart? I've seen rich folks poorer than a penniless man. I've seen poor folks richer than the king of Siam. And what it comes down to, you have a brand new heart. Here we go now, I got a brand new heart. Brand new heart. Brand new heart.
give you a ha ha. Don't matter who, everybody, girls, people. Young, there's a song to be sung. A word on the street about God's only son. How he lived, how he died, how he lives again. And we can find a life that will never, ever end. It's true, I know there's a reason for joy. The changes he made right here in this old boy have given me a chance at a brand new start. A brand new dream and a brand new heart. I got a brand new heart. Brand new heart. Brand new heart. Brand new heart. Let me tell you about my brand new heart. Brand
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate that very, very much. You know, I so enjoyed our singing together earlier, and I don't really want to listen just to me all night. So I thought it might be fun if we did a song together. Now, the song that I want to teach you is called I Am Set Free. And this song is actually a competition between the men and the ladies. So we know who's going to win, right, men? Now, I brought along a CD of my music, and that's going to be a prize. So if the men win, one of the men will win the CD. But if the ladies win the competition, one of the ladies will win. So let me teach you your parts. First of all, I want to start with the men. Men, your part is very easy. It's designed for us men. Very simple, okay? There's only two things you have to remember, men. Only two simple things. Number one, my right arm is going to go out to the front like that. That's number one. When my right arm goes out to the front like that, if you consider yourself a man here tonight, then you go, oh, that's pretty simple, right? Okay, guys, can we do that? Okay, remember part one, part two? Oh, here we go, man. One, two, three. Guys, what was part one? Arm out in the front, right? Okay, the arm has to go out first, then we do our O. Okay, we got it now, man. Here we go. One, two, three. Okay, let me ask the ladies a question. Ladies, do you find that men have trouble following simple instructions sometimes? Yes. I find if my wife asks me to do one thing, I can do that so well. But if she asks me to do two things, I come back and the first thing's done and I'm so excited. And she's like, what about the other thing? I'm like, oh yeah, I forgot that. Okay. So men, I'm really going to put my arm out this time. Here we go. One, two, three. Oh! This time everyone's like, I'm not doing it. He's not going to put his arm out. Okay, men, one more time. One, two, three. Nice. Now, ladies, you have a special part as well. You have to be louder than the men are. And I can only do your part one time because I am definitely not a lady. When my left arm goes out, ladies, you go, oh, like that, okay? And you have to try and be louder than the men. Okay, ladies, one, two, three. Okay, excellent. Men, ladies, men, ladies. And then everyone together goes, oh, so do that with me. Oh, right? Men again. Ladies, men, ladies, everyone, oh. And then the best part of all, I'm going to give you a signal like this. And when I give you this signal, that means you jump up and you go, yeah, 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 like that. Okay? Now, I'm going to be watching for someone that does a great yeah, 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 yeah. And that person is going to win the CD, okay? So this arm is for the men and this arm is for the ladies. When I do this, it's jump up and go, yeah, 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 yeah. And this is called I Am Set Free. Here go.
Jesus is the man. Take him by the hand. Gonna tell the whole land. I am set free. I was full of sin. Jesus took me in. Now I got a grin. And I am set free, man. Oh. Yeah, 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 yeah. He knew me from the start. Now he's in my heart. I will do my part and I am set free. Truth cuts like a knife. Lifts me from the strife. Now I got new life and I am set free, man. Oh. Oh, here we go now. Yeah, 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 yeah. He knew me from the start. Now he's in my heart. I will do my part and I am set free. Truth cuts like a knife. Lifts me from the strife. Now I got the life and I am set free, man. Oh, the men are winning. Come on, ladies. Oh, here we go. Yeah, 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 yeah. Jesus is the man. Take him by the hand. Gonna tell the whole land. I am set free. I was full of sin. Jesus took me in. Now I got a grin and I am set free, man. Oh. Oh, here we go now. Yeah, 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 yeah. Jesus is the man. Take him by the hand. Gonna tell the whole land. I am set free. I was full of sin. Jesus took me in. Now I got a grin. I am set free. How many of you think that the ladies were the loudest? And how many of you think the men were the loudest? Well, it was honestly very, very close. But just by this much, the winners are the men. So let's give them a big hand. And I was watching very, very carefully for all of you. And it was interesting. During the jump up part, there's basically three types of people. The first type, they jump up and they go crazy. They don't care what they look like. And one of those people is about to get the CD. The second group are the people, they really want to do it, but they're worried about what they're going to look like. So they kind of stand halfway up and look around. Okay. And then the third group is the people that just sit there and go, I am not doing that. There is no way. So from that first group, there is one of the men who caught my eye, and he did such an amazing job. And he's sitting right over. Excuse me, pardon me, sorry. He's sitting right over, excuse me. He's sitting right over there. And sorry, guys. I feel a little bad, but not too bad. It's actually this young man right here. Come on out for a second. Just come on out here. Now, what is your first name? Sorry? Dejes? Did you know that you're an amazing dancer? Yes. But there's only one small problem. None of these people got to see what an amazing dancer you really are. So you and I together, we'll do one, okay? Okay, on the count of three. One. Oh, yeah, we better put our stuff down. Okay, one, two, three. There you go. Give him a big hand, everybody. Excellent job. I hope you enjoy the CD. Thank you. Well, if you have your Bible with you, I invite you to turn to Matthew 18:3. And Matthew 18:3, Jesus is speaking to us, and he says this. I tell you the truth, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. And when I read this, I remember I was about 25 years old when I really seriously considered, what does this mean? And I had spent my whole life trying to grow up and become a man. And suddenly Jesus was telling me that I should be like a little child. And so I talked to my pastor about what this means, and I looked in some big, thick theological books, and I went to a Bible college and asked them there what it meant. But there was still something missing in my heart. I was thinking there's something more than just the meaning of the Greek words and all those things. There's something deeper than that. So I started watching my daughter, who was 5 years old at the time. And I thought to myself, if Jesus wants me to be like a little child, I should be like my little daughter. And then I'll be what he wants me to be. But I wasn't sure which part of her I was supposed to copy. For example, when we went in the car, she would always say, "Are we there yet? I have to go to the bathroom. Hey, there's a McDonald's, Dad, please." So I thought, well, maybe that's what Jesus means. So the next time we went in the car, even though I was driving, I looked at my wife and said, "Are we there yet? I have to go to the bathroom. There's a McDonald's." No, it didn't seem to help my spiritual life, and it was not good for my marriage either. Then I watched what else she liked. She liked to eat candy a lot. And we have a type of candy in Canada. It's a big piece of sugar like a finger, and you suck on it to make it wet, and then you stick it in other colored sugars, and then you suck the sugar off of the sugar until the sugar's all gone. Then you eat this sugar. So I bought a big box of that, and I ate it every day. And I got three cavities and this big belly right here. And it didn't help my spiritual life either. So I thought, that's not what it is. It's not whining and complaining. It's not eating sweets. What could it be? Well, one day we went to the swimming pool together. Now, I wish that I could take you all to Canada to show you what happened, but we can't. So instead, I hope it's okay, Pastor, we're just going to turn this room into a big swimming pool. Is that okay? Okay, excellent. So I want all of you to pretend that you're, stay seated as you are, but I want you to pretend that you're standing in the water about this deep, okay? Now, you're going to have to really use your imagination because I'm going to play the part of a cute little five-year-old girl, okay? I'm going to play the part of my daughter. And, sir, you didn't know it, but you're going to play the part of Dad, okay? What's your name? Okay. Kapanen, this is what happened. My daughter said to me, "Dad, you get in the deep water, and I'm going to stand up on the edge of the pool." And can you imagine what she wanted to do? Yeah, that's right. So you can stay seated, but just pretend that you're here up to the water, okay? Okay. "Dad, are you ready to catch me?" Okay. You should see his face. It's so good. It's perfect. Okay. "But Daddy, I'm really scared because I don't know how to swim, and the water is so deep. Daddy, are you sure you're going to catch me? You sure? Okay. Okay, put your arms out, Dad. Okay, a little bigger. I'm a big little... I'm not that big. Come on. I'm big, but I'm not huge. Come on." I'm just teasing. So my daughter took about 20 minutes to jump because she was so afraid. But I won't take 20 minutes. I'll jump in just a few seconds. You don't have to worry, okay? So she asked me one more time, "Are you sure you're going to catch me? But Daddy, I'm so scared." "Okay, Dad. Okay, on the count of three. Ready? Okay, okay. One. Two. Three. Mom, make sure you watch. I'm going to jump into Dad's arms, okay? Okay, you be ready to watch, because I don't want you to miss when I jump in Daddy's arms, okay?" Sorry about that. So finally, after 20 minutes, she looked to the left and looked to the right. She asked me one more time, "Are you sure you're going to catch me?" Okay. She made sure Mom was watching. Okay. And then, with everything she had, she jumped into my arms. And that's okay. Give him a big hand. I guess that would be an indication that I really did eat too much candy. There's no doubt about that. But thank you for catching me. Now, when I was at the swimming pool with my daughter, and I was being the dad, I had my arms out for 20 minutes, and I thought, why is it so hard for my little girl to jump? Well, number one, she did not know how to swim. And number two, the water was way over her head. So she actually had to risk her life to jump into that water. And as she was standing up there looking down at me, there were two questions going through not just her mind, they were going through her heart. Question number one, as she looked down at me, does my daddy really love me? And number two, is my daddy strong enough to catch me? And when she determined in her heart, yes, my daddy really loves me, and he's strong enough to catch me, suddenly it didn't matter how deep the water was. Suddenly it didn't matter that she couldn't swim. All that mattered was her daddy loves her, and her daddy's strong enough to catch her. And when she jumped into my arms, it was as if the Lord said to me, "Sam, that's what I'm talking about. I want you to have that kind of relationship with your Father in heaven. Just like you saw your little girl trust you with her life, that's what I want you to do." Now, I came across a little photograph that sums up what it might be like. You see the look on this little girl's face? It's not joy yet. She's actually very afraid. But in just a few moments, she's going to be wrapped up in the strong arms of her daddy. And then she's going to laugh and she's going to giggle and she's going to say four words. And I know these four words. I've heard them 1,000 times from my children. The four words are, "Let's do it again. Daddy, can we do it again?" And you see, I know that in your life, the water is deeper than you want it to be. And you wish that you were a better swimmer. I do too. But the truth is, we have a Father who loves us. And we have a Father who's strong enough to catch us. So instead of waking up in the morning and saying, "Oh, the water's just too deep. I don't know how to swim." We can wake up in the morning and say, "Let's do it again." And we can live out of the abundant love that our Father has for us. Now, speaking of abundant love, I wrote a song a little while back. And this song is called Everlasting Love. And I'm just going to bring it up on the screen. Now, there's a part in this song that I want to teach you, and we'll sing it together. And the part that we sing together goes like this. Whoa, 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 oh. Whoa, 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 whoa. Whoa, 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 oh. Whoa, 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 whoa. Now, just before we do the song, let's do a practice of it, and I'd like you all to sing that part with me, okay? Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. Whoa, 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 whoa. Let me hear you now. Whoa, 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 whoa. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Now, whenever I start to sing that song, it always reminds me of the times that I've been in Africa and done that song. And in Africa, no one would ever sit down for this song. Everyone stands up and claps and moves with a lot of joy. So for this one song, we're going to pretend that we're in Africa together, okay? So I want to invite you to stand up with me right now, and we're going to do this the way they do it in Africa. And the clap is like this. And I want to see you move around a little bit. And sing it out. That's right. Here we go. Yeah, 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 yeah. Here's where we sing it together now. Down in the valley, what you have seen on the hill, for I will supply everything that you need as you walk within my will. Yeah, yeah, I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have loved you with an everlasting love. Walk humbly before me. Walk gently by faith, reflecting the love I have given to you. Messenger of my grace, yeah, yeah. I have loved you with an everlasting love.
everlasting love. I have loved you with an everlasting love.
Here's where we sing it out now.
Oh, oh, oh.
Let's see those hands. Give yourselves a big hand. Great job. And have a seat for just a moment. Now, as we were singing that song, I was thinking about the scripture that says, I believe it's Jeremiah, says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. And I want to tell you about a time that I didn't know that at all. I was about 15 years old. And I want you to think back for a moment to when you were 15 years old. And I don't know what your life was like when you were 15, but when I was 15, life was not going very well. School was not going very well. I didn't have very many friends, but I had one good thing. And that one good thing was my family. My mom and my dad, my brothers and my sister. And I thought to myself, no matter how difficult life is, I'll always have that one good thing. Until the Friday afternoon when my mother walked into my room and she told me that I didn't have that one good thing anymore. She said to me, Sam, in 2 weeks' time, I'm moving away. I thought I should let you know. I'm taking your sister and your brother with me, and I'm leaving your father. You can come with me if you want to, or you can stay here. It's up to you. And then she turned and walked out of the room. Well, maybe if I had have had one other good thing in my life, it wouldn't have torn my heart apart so badly. But suddenly I went from thinking I had kind of a normal life, even though it wasn't perfect, to having everything that I loved just torn apart. Now, only 4 hours later, I found myself gathered in a room like this. It wasn't quite as big, but it was a room like this, full of young people, because I'd been invited to go on a weekend camp with a church. And so we were gathered in this room, and it was on the edge of a beautiful lake. And there was a man in the front speaking, and I was sitting in about the third row right where you're sitting. And I don't know if you're listening to me or not, but when I was sitting where you're sitting, I wasn't listening. You're not listening either? Okay. All I could think about was that the only hope I had was being torn apart. And as I sat where you're sitting, I saw no future for myself, I saw no hope, and I had no love. And the tears began to stream down my face. And I covered my eyes so the other young people wouldn't see me, because I knew what they would say if they saw a 15-year-old young man crying like I was crying. They'd say, hey, come here, look at this guy. He's crying like a baby. What a loser. Look at this guy. But I didn't even care about that. Because as I sat where you're sitting, I came up with a plan. You see, they taught us in school that the human brain will begin to die after only 4 minutes without oxygen. And as I looked out the window, I saw that beautiful lake and the sun setting down. And I thought to myself, as soon as the man at the front stops talking, I can slip out the back and I can run down to that lake. I can run along the dock, dive in off the end, swim down 3 meters into the dark water, and hold on underwater to the pole of the dock. And if I can hold on for only 4 minutes, I will never have to experience this kind of pain ever again. Well, just about that time, the man in the front stopped talking. And I started to get up to go. But some of those other young people did see me. And they came up to me and they gathered around me. And I thought, this is going to be even worse than I thought. But there was something incredible about these young people. First, they asked me what was wrong. And I was crying so hard I couldn't even answer. And then they did something, even though it was 35 years ago, I will never forget. They knelt down beside me. They put their hand on my knee and on my shoulder. And these young people that I didn't even know, they began to pray for me. Now, I had big, red, swollen eyes from crying. I had snot running down my nose from sobbing. All they should have done was laughed at me, pointed at me, made fun of me, maybe even spit on me. But instead, they loved me. And that night, I discovered a new kind of love. You see, whether you're from India or Canada or anywhere else in the world, we all know about a certain kind of love. And this kind of love is called I will love you if love. It says, I will love you if you look a certain way. It says, I will love you if you're very wealthy. I will love you if you're the captain of the cricket team. I will love you if you have something that I want. But the problem with that kind of love is it's not trying to give anything to anyone. It only wants to take. But that night, I discovered on the lowest night of my life a new kind of love. And it was as if Jesus reached his hand out to me that day. It was as if he reached his hand out to me and said, I know all about you, and I love you. Before you knew or cared about me, I loved you. You might feel that you have no hope, but I've got enough hope for both of us. You might feel, and you here tonight might feel like I felt, you might feel like you don't have a future. And the living God says, I have enough future for both of us. You see, he knows everything we've ever done, and he loves us. We don't have to try to hide from him. We don't have to brush our teeth and gargle and get our hair a certain way and then try to come close, because he knows us in all of our shortcomings. And your pastor referred to a verse from 1 John. I believe it's 1 John 4:10 that says, this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and gave his son as a sacrifice for us. So there is not a single person in this room that needs to leave this place tonight before you are free. And you can become more free tonight than you've ever been in your life. I'm sure that many or most of you are Christians. You've opened your heart to Jesus. You put your trust in him and you're following him. But our relationship with God is a process. And even though I've been a Christian for a long time, I've been finding that in these last few years, God has been giving me new levels of freedom that I never thought possible. And I'm not here to tell you that my life is perfect or that it's easy or that everything is just so. It's not. It's still messy sometimes. My heart still aches over certain things. Even when I began to follow Jesus, my parents did not get back together. In fact, it was a mess for about 35 more years, and then my mom finally passed on. And it was just a difficult, heartbreaking situation. But something changed in my life. Because I knew that if on the darkest, emptiest, loneliest, most hopeless night of my life, if Jesus could reach out to me and love me there, then there would be nothing that could separate me from his love. But the Bible says in Matthew 10:39, if we hold on to our own lives, we'll lose them. But if we risk everything to lay them down to Jesus and to his kingdom, then we'll find more life than we ever thought possible. As I was praying in preparation for this trip to India, I was spending some time with the Lord, and I was saying, Lord, what's the message that you want me to share? And there were two things that came across very clearly. Number one, of course, he said, share about my son and share about his life and call people to lay down their lives and follow Christ. That's number one. And he said, but number two is that you would call Christian people in India to lay down their lives and serve the kingdom and share the message across this great land. And I believe that God wants to call 100,000 Indian people to become missionaries to their own land. And you might say, oh, I could never do that. But the truth is, if you put your life in God's hands, you don't have to worry about this future or that future. That becomes his business. Now, I came across a little video clip that I want to show. And it's from a movie called Forrest Gump. And in this scene, Forrest Gump is a little boy. And he has braces on his legs. And he can barely walk. He walks kind of like this. And some very mean people come and start throwing rocks at him. And he has no choice but to try to run away. And as he begins to run, he experiences a miracle. And when I saw this clip for the first time, it touched me very deeply. And I not only saw that little boy, but I saw myself at 15 years old. Now, I did not have braces on my legs, physical braces, but I had braces all over my life. Braces that said, no one will ever love you. Braces that said, you're not good enough. Braces that said, you might as well kill yourself. But that night when Jesus reached out to me through his spirit, through those young people, he began to break the braces off in my life. So as we watch this clip, you'll see the little boy run across the screen, and you might even think about me and what God began to do that night in my life. But more than any of that, I want you to think about your life and begin to dream dreams of more freedom in the Lord than you've ever experienced before. And begin to ask the Lord, Lord, in what way do you want me to become more free than I've ever been before?
Now, my mom always told me that miracles happen every day. Some people don't think so, but they do.
Hey, dummy! Are you blind or just plain stupid?
Look, I'm Forrest Gump.
Just run away, Forrest.
Run, Forrest! Run away! Hurry!
Get the bikes!
Hurry up! Let's get it! Come on!
Look out, dummy! Here we come!
Let me get you!
Run, Forrest! Run! Run, Forrest!
We're back here, you!
I told you.
But I can run like the wind blows. From that day on, if I was going somewhere, I was running.
Now, I absolutely love that whole clip, but my favorite part is the last few seconds as he's running across that beautiful green field. When I was 15 years old, if you had have told me there was a beautiful green field ahead for me, I would have laughed in your face. But that's what God did for me. That's a visual picture of what God did for me. Again, I'm not trying to say that it's always easy or always fun. Sometimes it's so tough. But walking hand in hand with him is so worth it. And I feel led tonight to really challenge you in a way that's going to make you get up out of your seat. I'm going to do a little bit more music. I want to share a couple more scriptures. But when our time is done, I'm going to teach you a final song. And I'm going to ask you to respond to one of those two challenges. Maybe you're here tonight visiting with a friend or a family member, and you're like I was. You believe in God. He's out there somewhere. But tonight, you sense that he's reaching his hand out to you and saying, tonight is your night. You can begin a new relationship with me. You can experience forgiveness and hope and everlasting love. But you've got to take my hand and you've got to trust me. As we sing this simple song towards the end, I'm going to invite you to get up out of your seat and come to the front here and say, yes. But I also want to speak to the Christian people here. You see, as Christians, we can have this attitude of, oh, of course we love God and we go to church and we pray, but we have this list of things that we want God to give us. All good things. And we say, God, I want this kind of job and this kind of car and this kind of wife or husband. And Lord Jesus, amen, could you just give me these things? Amen, in Jesus' name. But when I read the Bible, I don't see God asking for our list. But I do see him asking for our life. And so to the Christian people here, I'm going to challenge you. Instead of laying down your list to God, who here would lay down their life to him? Now, what God does with your life after that, that's up to him. It's not up to you. You don't have to worry about it. But all you have to do is be willing and say, yes, God, I will lay my life down like a blank piece of paper to you, and I want you to take it up and write your story across my life so that people will know that I'm alive. So that's what we're going to be doing later. So between now and then, for about 10 minutes, I really want you to listen for God's voice. Listen for his voice speaking to you. And when you hear his voice, would you dare to obey it? Now, there's some certain things in life that show us what's important. And I'm going to put a picture up of one of those things that reminds me of what's important in life. This is an ultrasound of my son. And we went for an ultrasound test, oh, many years ago now. And that we actually knew the lady who was doing the ultrasound. So she gave us a little video clip of him moving around in there. And you know from these ultrasound tests, they can tell if it's a boy or a girl. And if you're not sure how that works, you can just ask the pastor afterwards, and he'll explain how they tell if it's a boy or a girl, okay? But I want to let you know that in this little video clip, he moves around a little bit. And I don't want you to be shocked, because it's very obvious that he's a little boy. So let's watch it together for a second. So you can tell it's a boy, right? Now, we really did go to the ultrasound place. And the next day we got a note from our doctor explaining that we were having a beautiful baby boy. He was due in 3 months' time and he was absolutely perfect. Some friends of ours named Randy and Darla were expecting their very first. This was our third child. This was their first. And they went for an ultrasound test as well. But instead of getting a note from the doctor the next day, they got a phone call almost as soon as they got home from the test. And the doctor said, I need you to come down to my office right now. I need you to come down and see me right now. Don't worry about an appointment. Just come. And within 5 minutes, they were sitting in his office. And the doctor explained that just like my wife and I, they were expecting a beautiful baby boy. And just like my wife and I, he was due in 3 months' time. But the problem was that his little heart was not developing properly. It was the wall between the two sides of his heart. And so they had some decisions to make. The first option was that they could have an abortion, and that little boy would be gone by the next afternoon. The second option was that they could have their child in 3 months' time, but his heart was probably not strong enough to keep him alive. But there was a third option. And the third option was that they could have their little boy in 3 months' time. But as soon as he was born, they would take him into the operating room and try to rebuild his heart. But the doctor explained that there were no guarantees. Well, my friends decided on that third option. So 3 months later, my son Taylor was born. And 2 weeks after that, their son Bryce was born. And I wrote a song for Bryce and his family that I would like to sing for you now. And the song is called 20 Minutes to Say,
I love you.
Doctor knew there was a problem, though his birth was still at least 3 months away. His tiny heart, oh, it was struggling. The doctors offered no guarantee that day. 14 weeks and 3 days later, little Bryce was finally born. The surgical team was prepped and ready, but they gave his parents time with their firstborn. They had 20 minutes to say, I love you. 20 minutes to hold him in their arms. Those 20 minutes passed like the twinkling of an eye. Then the nurses came to get him, and he was gone. The operation took much longer than they'd planned for it to be. The doctor finally came tell them both the news. It was not news they were ready to receive. His little heart was just too broken. Oh, and there was nothing left to say. His father fell to his knees. His heart was broken too, but it was broken in a much more painful way, because they had only 20 minutes to say, I love you. 20 minutes to hold him in their arms. In those 20 minutes, they spent a lifetime, because in 20 minutes, he was gone. I don't know why death has taken their son, when life has brought a little boy to me. But I'll remember the final notes have not yet played in this unfinished symphony. So I'll take 20 minutes to say, I love you. 20 minutes to hold you in my arms. I realize now that even 20 minutes is a gift. So let me simply hold you and tell you how I love you. Every moment that we share is a gift of grace. Oh. And as I sat with Bryce's parents a few days after Bryce passed on, they told me something very interesting. They said, Sam, of course we're brokenhearted to lose our son. But the truth is, we knew that we might only have 20 minutes with him. And Sam, we loved him. Every moment that we had with him, we loved him. And they said what they think is an even greater tragedy is when people have months or years together and they waste it. They let stupid things get in the way of their relationships. They don't make the most of the opportunities that God gave them to really live, even though they may have 50 or 60 or 70 years.
King David was talking to God one day, and he said this in Psalm 39, verses 4 and 5. He said, "Show me, O Lord, my life's end, and the number of my days. Let me know how fleeting my life is. You have made my days a mere handbreadth. The span of my years is as nothing before you. Each person's life is but a breath." And the truth is, one day soon, every single one of us will stand on the edge of eternity before the living God. For some of us, it might be 5 years away. For some, it might be 25 years. For some, it might be 50 years. I don't know. But no matter how long it is, on that day that we stand on the edge of eternity and we look back over our whole lives, it's going to feel like we had 20 minutes. It's going to feel like our 20 minutes on the earth went like that. Think of all the generations who have been born and lived and died before us, generation after generation after generation, and they're finished on this planet. And now, for a few brief moments, it's our turn. And when you stand before God on that day, He's going to look you in the eye. He's going to call you by name, and He's going to ask you the most important question you have ever been asked. He's going to ask you the most important question you will ever be asked in all of eternity. After He calls you by name, He's going to say, "My child, what did you do with the 20 minutes that I gave you to live?" It's all spelled out, actually, in the book of Romans. In Romans 14, 10 to 12, it says this. "As surely as I live, says the Lord, we will all stand before God's judgment seat. It is written, 'As surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will acknowledge God.' So then each of us will give an account of himself to God." Now, on that day, there will be many people who are ashamed and frightened to give an account of themselves to God. But it does not have to be a fearful day for us. It does not have to be a shameful day. In fact, it can be the most joyful experience of your whole life, because there is not one person in this room that is beyond the grace of the living God. He knew that we would need His help. He's not surprised by that. He knew that He would have to send His Son to live a perfect and pure and holy and wonderful life, and then to die on the cross to pay the price for our selfishness and our sin. But if we simply say, "God, based on what Jesus did for me, would you forgive me? Would you help me to make a new start? Would you wash over me by your Spirit?" And not only did Jesus die on the cross, but 3 days later, He rose from the grave, and the Bible says that the power that brought Him back to life is available to you and I to live a whole new life. You know, tonight, your Father in heaven is standing with His arms open wide, and we're up on the edge of the pool, and He's saying, "I want you to jump into my arms. I want you to jump and trust me." You know, my daughter took 20 minutes to finally jump. But imagine if she didn't jump for an hour and a half, and suddenly the lifeguards blew the whistle because it was time to close the pool. I would have had to get out of the pool and take her by the hand. She'd be still up, still dry, not wet. And I'd take her by the hand. We'd walk towards the change rooms, and she might say, "But Daddy, I'm ready to jump now." And I'd have to say, "Sweetheart, it's too late. The pool's closed. I wanted you in the water with me. I wanted you to experience what I planned for you to experience. But you chose not to trust me. You chose not to jump in my arms and find out just how much I love you and just how strong I am. So it's too late." And I do not want God to say that about you or me. And tonight, we have an opportunity to jump in a fresh way. And our relationship with God is not just saying yes one time. It's not just saying one prayer one time. But it's continually jumping into His arms and saying, "Daddy, let's do it again." So you may be a Christian here, and you sense that God is saying, "I want you to trust me for something new. I'm not necessarily going to tell you what it is, but are you ready for it? Will you receive it?" then as we sing this simple song in a few minutes, I invite you to come and stand here. And there's nothing magical about coming to the front, but it says, God, I am seeking your face. I am making myself available to you. I am jumping into your arms. Or you may be here like I was, and you're not sure if you've ever begun that relationship with God. Or maybe you know you haven't, but tonight you can do that too. And it's as simple as opening up your heart to him and saying, forgive me. I put my trust in what you've done, Jesus. Cleanse me and help me to follow you with my whole heart. You know, it really just comes down to a very simple option. Option number one says this: I believe that I know more than God, therefore I will determine what is best for me and how I will live. And I would dare say that many people, even who call themselves Christians, in reality are living like this. Because they're keeping control of their own life. They're going to stay up on the edge of the pool and they are not jumping. Because if you jump, you're giving away your control to the living God. But there is a second option, and the second option says this: I believe that God knows more than I do. Therefore, I will risk everything to follow him and to serve him. Have you been listening for his voice calling you tonight? Calling you to something deeper. Calling you to something freer. Calling you to a place that doesn't depend on your own strength, but depends on his strength working through you. So these are the words to the song. It's taken from also from Jeremiah, where God says, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart. So I'm going to teach you this simple song, and then we'll stand together to sing it. But then we're going to open up this front area to every single person here. And I do not want you to come forward just because other people are doing it. That is not the right reason. That's just pretending. But you will know, even if no one else comes and God is speaking to you, then you come. And allow God to do what he wants to do in your life. Give God the freedom to give you the freedom. The song goes like this. I will seek you with my whole heart. Father, help me make a new start. I give my life to you. Lord, I give my life to you. I will seek you with my whole heart. Father, help me make a new start. I give my life to you, Lord, I give my life to you. So I invite you to stand with me now, and we're going to sing this song together to the Lord. And you know, we're not just going to sing it as a song, but we're going to sing it from the depth of our heart to the depth of God's heart. And then the Lord is calling many of you, I believe, to, in a fresh way, to lay your life down to him. For some of you here, there's burdens that you have been carrying for much too long. Burdens that you've been carrying. Perhaps it's unforgiveness, or perhaps it's shame, or perhaps it's fear. But tonight, God is saying, come and lay that burden at my cross, at the foot of my cross. Don't leave this place carrying it any longer. You've carried it for too long. It's time to let it go. And for others here, there's things that the Lord wants you to take hold of. To take hold of a new dream, to take hold of a new hope, to take hold of a new love. So for some, it's a letting go. And for some, it's a taking hold. So as we sing this simple song, I invite you to come to the front here and say, God, I lay my life before you like a blank piece of paper. No matter what anyone else does or does not do, you certainly know by now if God has got a call on your life. So as we sing this simple song, you come, lay your life before him like a blank piece of paper. I will seek you with my whole heart, Father. Help me make a new start. I give my life to you, Lord, I give my life to you. I will seek you with my whole heart. Father, help me make a new start. I give my life to you, Lord, I give my life to you. And maybe it's not your custom to come forward in this place, and that may be the case, and I understand that. But tonight, as God is speaking to your heart, it's going to take two things, faith and courage. Imagine that you're a little child, and you're on the edge of the pool, and right in this moment, your Heavenly Father has his arms open wide, and he says, I love you, and I'm strong enough to catch you, and I'm calling you, no matter what anyone else does or doesn't do, to step out and jump into my arms. So as we sing it together once or twice more now, you come. You jump into his arms. Let Jesus meet you in this place. Let him be the strength of your life in a fresh way. As we sing it together, just step out from where you are. Just say, excuse me, sorry, pardon me, and come.
I will seek you with my whole heart. Father, help me make a new start. I give my life to Lord, I give my life to you. I will seek you with my whole heart. Father, help me make a new start. I give my life to you. Lord, I give my life to you.
Some of the most precious memories of my life are the days when God called me in a fresh way and I stepped out. And boy, I was so afraid. I remember when the Lord said, Sam, I was already a Christian for 5 years. He said, Sam, lay your life down like a blank piece of paper. I was so afraid to give my future away. And I said, but Lord, if I say yes, what will my life look like? If I say no, what will my life look like? And it was as if the Lord said to me, Sam, you're not saying yes or no to this life or that life. You're saying yes or no to me. And if you say yes to me, Sam, you don't have to worry about your future. That'll become my business. And that was 30 years ago now. And the Lord has made a way for me. And he will make a way for you. I'm not going to drag it out too long, but there may be one or two more, so we're going to sing it one more time. And you know if God has been speaking to you. And so if he has, I'll just invite you to step out as well and come to the front, and then I'm going to lead you in a short prayer. Let's sing it one more time.
I will seek you with my whole heart. Father, help me make a new start. I give my life to you. Lord, I give my life to you. I will seek you with my whole heart. Father, help me make a new start. I give my life to you. Lord, I give my life to you.
Now I want to lead you all in a prayer. And I understand that you're here for many different reasons. For some, it may be coming to Christ for the very first time and trusting him. And for others, you've been Christians for a while, but you know that God's calling you in a fresh way. But I'll pray, and then you repeat out loud after me. Dear God, thank you for loving me. Forgive me of my sins. Forgive me of my selfishness. Wash me clean today. Help me to follow you with my whole heart. I jump into your arms tonight. I trust you with my life. I trust you with my future. I lay my life down to you like a blank piece of paper. Write the story of my life. in a way that pleases you. And use me in your kingdom to bring your life and your love to hurting people. Father, thank you that you love me, that you're strong enough to catch me. I am your child, and I love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now, I want to just pray a blessing over you who are at the front and also each one here. And just before I do, I want to say one last thing. When our lives are done, and for everyone in this room, they'll be done soon, it's going to feel like we only had 20 minutes to live. And don't you want to be able to say that you trusted the living God, that you risked everything to follow him, and that you wouldn't change a thing because of his grace in your life? Even though it was hard sometimes, even though you felt broken sometimes, even though you wondered if you could go on, he never gave up on you. And he used your life and made something beautiful out of it. That's my prayer for all of us. So that when we meet together on that shore one day, we can talk about tonight, and we can talk about all the things that God did between now and then, and we can spend 10, 20, 30,000 years just together praising the Lord before we go and talk to some other people, because we're not going to be in a rush. I don't want to miss a thing that he has for us, none of us. And we can live a powerful, courageous life, not because we're so strong, but because he is so strong. So Heavenly Father, I want to thank you so much tonight for your grace upon our lives. I want to thank you for men and women who would dare in the 21st century to say, yes, I lay my life down to you, Lord. Take it and use it and glorify yourself. Do whatever you want with my life. I give you control. Father, I thank you that your Spirit still meets us at our point of need when we jump into your arms. So, Father, I commit each one to you, and I ask that day by day, when we wake up in the morning, we wouldn't say, oh, the water's so deep, but we'd say, Daddy, let's do it again. Show me how to love you. Show me how to love others. Use me to make a difference in this world and in your kingdom. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.